All right, today we're talking about using video. So what we're gonna talk about today is why we want to use video in our ministry. What equipment do we need to create videos? Some techniques and tips for shooting good video. Since a lot of video work is also done with YouTube, we're going to talk about YouTube a little bit, and then, as always, some homework assignments. First off, why would we even bother using video in church? And aside from the fact that it's a technology that's becoming easily accessible now, and people are actually becoming more to expect it in just about any venue they enter, video appeals to both the senses of sight and hearing, and because of that, video is very powerful and very emotion-evoking, and that makes it very desirable and easy for people to share that kind of information. As we talked about in the presentation 2 weeks ago on mobile, mobilizing your ministry, it's one thing to share text where people can read your thoughts and ideas, and it's another one to maybe see a picture or hear a podcast, but when they see video that integrates both sight and sound, that becomes a very impactful way of conveying a message or telling a story. Some ways that you can use video at church, there's a bunch of ways that you can use it, but the two primary reasons for using video in your ministry is either to ask questions or to call people to action. And by asking a question, what I'm proposing here is a format where your video is not a self-contained message, but instead it gets people pondering a thought or an idea. For instance, you maybe shoot a video, let's say that your Sunday message this week is going to be about the nature of God. So you might shoot a video that asks a question, well, who is God? What is the nature of God? And there's different ways that you can put that video together. Three of the most popular is just telling stories, sharing testimonials, and using interviews. And let me break those out a little bit more as well. By telling stories, you are interviewing either basically one or two, maybe three people who share a common experience or perspective, and they're basically having a conversation with the camera where they talk about an event or their past or, like I said, a shared perspective. And it's just very conversational, like you'd have a conversation in your living room with friends who've come over. For instance, relating to the nature of God, you might have, if you're shooting a single person, they might talk about how as a kid they asked people who is God, and nobody had a really good answer. So as a teenager, they investigated that more, but most of their answers came from television movies and movies at the theater and such that their friends had, so they ended up with a very confused perspective of who God is, and you can just kind of follow that story of that person as they try to evaluate and determine who God is. So it's very, very narrative, and like I said, with two or three people, they can kind of tell a story together. Now, similar to that is sharing a testimonial, but now with a testimonial is always focused on a single person, not several people. Like, you can't have it telling a story. Now, you may have cut-ins with people offering other perspective, but a testimonial really should be just a single person. And then the idea with the testimonial is that the eventual end of the testimonial is how this person either came to a relationship with Christ or the relationship with Christ was strengthened. So testimonials and stories can be very similar, but testimonials tend to be more introspective in the narrative, whereas telling stories can be, like I said, more about events and perspectives and opinions and such. Now, another way that you can pose questions is by doing an interview, which asks questions, and you sit down one or several people, and you ask them questions and then respond to it. Like you see on pretty much any news talk show type interview. Now, why posing questions is such a powerful way to tell video or tell a story is because instead of trying to create a video that's self-contained, that has both the question and the answer, the video instead just has the question, and it's your Sunday message that has the answer. So this video, in this hypothetical example, talking about the nature of God, so we pose all these questions or get people thinking about these ideas, probably things that they've considered on their own, but they don't have the answer to. Well, if they want the answer, they can either, come to your church and talk with somebody, or they can see a Sunday sermon, or if you've got your sermons taped and they're available online, they can go into the archive and look at those as well. So it's a very powerful format of posing questions and using your sermons to provide the answers. Another way that you can use video is calling people to action. And that can be, you know, we need you to sign up, or not we need you, but, you know, we're starting a special Bible study. It's going to run for 8 weeks. It's going to be every other Thursday. Sign up, you know, that kind of thing. Or it can be, you know, we've got a community project going on. We need you to come out and volunteer your time for that. And, you know, here's where you can sign up kind of thing. But call to action, you can still do these three techniques. Sharing a testimonial, though, usually talks about the relationship between the person and God. So unless the call to action is somehow related to that, you're really going to be either telling a story or using an interview. And with calls to action, telling stories is great, because if you've got a community event that's going on, and especially if it's one that you do regularly, it's great to get stories from people who have done the event before and why did they decide to get involved with it. First off, what were some of their hesitations about getting involved, so we can get those addressed and out of the way. And then finally with, you know, what did I get out of this? You know, I went into this expecting to do this, but instead I found I got something else out of it as well that I wasn't really expecting. Now, if you want to see an example of interview format on our EPC YouTube channel, you can go to this website here, and you can see an interview I did with six EPC pastors here in the Detroit area who are working with 520 other churches in the Detroit area to change the Southeast Michigan region and recapture it for God. So that just gives you an example of what can be done with an interview. Okay, now what equipment do you need? Now, the thing with video, a lot of people think you need expensive cameras and lights and all this other stuff, and some of that stuff is great if you have it, but I'm going to show you that actually with just some simple amount of equipment, you can actually do some great videos. The basic equipment list, you need a good script, you need a camera, some good lighting, and good sound. Now, the only thing here you have to buy is the camera. Now, there's equipment that you can buy that will help you get good lighting and good sound, pardon me. You know, you can buy equipment that will help get you good lighting and good sound, but if things are set up right, you don't need the equipment. It's helpful, but it's not necessary. Obviously, you have to buy the camera, otherwise you've got no way to record your event. But the most important thing is a good script. And by a script, I mean you can either do a traditional script, like you're going to shoot a drama or a play. If you're doing an interview, you need good questions. Or if you're going to do something just kind of off the cuff, you still need a good outline, a good plan of what this content is going to be in this video. And I'm going to go into that a little bit more later, but these are the basics. You need to have a good script, camera, good lighting, and good sound. In fact, I've got two friends who are professional videographers, and they've told me that you can have the most high-end, top, expensive camera that Hollywood uses, and if you have bad lighting and bad sound, you will have a bad video. They said, surprisingly, the camera is the least important piece of equipment when shooting a video. If you don't have good lighting and good sound, you're going to have something that looks homemade, it's going to be difficult for people to understand, and it's going to turn them off no matter how good that script is. So, and I'll be coming back to that point, but I just, like I said, I've got these two friends, between the two of them, they've got almost 30 years combined videography experience, and they both could not emphasize to me enough just how important it is to have the good lighting and the good sound. Now, some nice-to-haves. Now, these actually, if you're going to do video on a regular basis, these are things that you should purchase as well. But if you're going to do video infrequently, and by that I mean if you're going to do video maybe two or three times a year, these are things that you don't necessarily need. But if you're going to do it more often than that, these are things you should start investing in. Video editing software, there's some great packages out there available for less than $100. And I'll be putting up a spreadsheet on the website, epc.org website, later, comparing some video editing software packages. But you need to look at what's important to you in terms of video editing software. Now, what the software can do for you, it allows you to delete all the mistakes, it allows you to correct some of the sound, it allows you to splice in some graphics or take the video that you shot and rearrange the pieces to tell the story a little differently. So it gives you some flexibility. You things that weren't shot perfectly wherever they were shot can now be fixed with the video editing software. In terms of selecting the software, the sprite view, again, you have to go back to what's important. Me, in my situation, I get video from a lot of different sources. So aside from keeping the price low, the most important thing for me was this video package that imported a ton of different formats. There were some great packages out there that had won awards, but they only accepted like three or four formats, and that wasn't going to work for me. Now, with you, with your situation, if you're going to be using only, you know, a church camera, or maybe, you know, you've got a couple of volunteers and they're both using the same format, then, you know, maybe that's not as big a consideration. Maybe the fades and transitions are more important to you. A tripod is good, again, if you're going to shoot on a regular basis. Tripod is great for one thing, it frees up your hands, so you can do other things. The other thing, it makes sure you get a nice steady shot. Spare batteries are good if you're going to do long takes, or you're going to be doing a lot of stuff, you know, quote-unquote, out in the field. So you can swap batteries between charges. You can have one charging while the other one is in use in the camera. A camera bag is good just to keep the equipment all together. The more traveling you do, the more investment you need to make in this camera bag. If your camera is going to be used primarily at the church, then a simple bag is fine. If you're going to do some more traveling, you need something with a lot of extra pockets to hold the extra tapes or flashcards, the spare batteries. You're probably going to have some cables. You want pockets for that. If you're going to be doing a lot of travel and you're going to spend some money on a really nice camera, and by that I mean like probably $500 more on a camera, then you probably want to get a clamshell case, one of those hard metal cases to protect your camera equipment. Remote mic or boom, again, this is important going back to that, you know, good sound makes good video. Most cameras have a good microphone. It's good up to maybe 6 feet, so as long as you do some close-in shooting, that's fine. But it will sound a little bit on the homemade side depending on the camera. Farther away than 6 feet, you're not only going to get that homemade sound, you're also going to get a drop-off in volume of the person that you're, or people that you're taping. You're also going to pick up more background noise the farther away you are from your subject. So that's where a remote mic, and a remote mic is one that pins to their person's shirt collar or whatever. A boom mic is one that attaches to the camera and sticks out like a kind of like a telescope. And those have a lot of extra sensitivity. The remote mic is better, but costs a lot more. Plus you've got extra batteries you have to keep track of. So that's where the boom mic might be fit better in your budget. And then some other more nice to haves. Headphones are good because that way, instead of picking up ambient noise, you can hear exactly what the camera's recording. So you can hear if you're picking up ambient noise, if the sound levels are okay, that kind of thing. Headphones are pretty cheap. Usually you can pick up a good set for about $30, $40. The lights, key lights, knockout lights, and backdrop lights, I'll talk about those a little bit more when I talk about lighting. Again, some of these things you can shoot around or, you know, using natural lighting, but if you have the equipment, it makes sure that you don't run into those problems. A windsock is good. It's a windsock. It's kind of a fuzzy piece of material that goes over your boom microphone, and it knocks out wind noise. So if you're going to be shooting a lot of outdoor video, windsocks are great to have. Okay, how do you shoot good video? And like I said, the camera is actually the least important piece of this entire production. I mean, it's good to have a good camera, and you do get better quality when you spend a little bit more on a camera, but like I said, there's a lot of other things to consider besides the camera that are actually more important. Again, going back to the script, content is still king. You can have the most perfectly framed shot with perfect lighting, crystal clear sound, and if the video is not relevant to what people want to see, they're going to tune you out. They're not even going to, you know, finish the video, unless they happen to be sitting there Sunday morning, in which case, you know, they're not going to get up and leave the sanctuary, but they're going to be bored for however long this video goes. So just like we've talked about in a lot of other of the webinars, we've got to make sure that the content is appropriate for the audience. You may have a video that the, you know, college and career crowd, the 18 to 25 crowd, you know, they like this video, they think it's great. So you think, well, let's show it Sunday morning, you know, for everybody. And unfortunately, most of your audience is 50 and older, and they don't relate to the subject that's being talked about. They don't relate to the way the video was shot, or vice versa. You know, you could have something that, you know, an older crowd appreciates and the younger crowd just doesn't get. So make sure that you're, whatever you're shooting, it's relevant. And like I said, these videos that set up the question that the sermon is going to answer, those can be really powerful combinations. Your call to actions, or even, you know, it doesn't even have to be a call to action. Maybe you just, you know, you want to get interviews from kids who went on a mission trip. Your high school and middle school group went on a mission trip. You want to capture that for historical purposes. That's great so long as there's a purpose for why you're putting the video together, and it's pretty obvious from watching the video what the purpose is. Like I said, you want to keep the content usually short, 3 to 5 minutes, especially if you're going to use it Sunday morning or you're going to put it on YouTube. 5 minutes is about the max. You can get away with something longer, but it's got to be really captivating and move along at a fairly decent pace. It's got to be focused. Make sure that your video is focused on one topic, maybe two if they somehow coincide, but keep it focused and, like I said, most of all, relevant. It's got to be relevant to your audience. Just some things to know about your script, and by script I mean either a traditional like drama script or it can be a set of questions you're using in an interview. With a script that you're shooting, usually if you shoot, if your video intentionally is intended to be 5 minutes long, you'll probably shoot 10, maybe 12 minutes of video because you'll do some retakes and such. But you've got a script that you're following. Just to let you know that when you shoot interviews, you're going to ask a question. You don't know how long it's going to take for the person to respond. There's a lot of stuff they're going to edit out. They may say something that triggers a thought, so you have another question you're going to ask, and then they get another response. You're only going to use about 10% of what you shoot. The URL I had earlier for a video that's on the EPC YouTube channel, the final video is less than 7 minutes, and that started as 54 minutes of taped interviews plus the minutes worth of graphics that I added in. So from 54 minutes, I got 6 minutes of usable video. And actually, there was a lot more that was usable, but I needed to keep it short. So just to let you know what to expect when you do interview-type videos, you're going to shoot a lot more than you need. There's a reason for that. And just don't be disappointed when you see how little video you actually end up using at the end. This is just a sample of a script. This is a traditional Hollywood-type format. Your title... Your cover page has the title in caps and then the date that you're shooting the video. Then the top of page one, you've got scene one, which is a description of the scene. The character's name is centered in caps. Below that, actor action, what's the actor doing, the camera angle. Is it tight? Is it close up? Is it long shot, wide angle? Camera action, is it panning, zooming? Is the camera still, it's still, you don't have to note that. Then below that dialogue, and then you just repeat the character actions and dialogue until the script is done or until you get to scene two, which starts at the beginning of another page. You can look online and find different script formats. I just wanted you to be aware that this is a typical format that you'll find. Now, if you're going to do an interview rather than a typical drama script, first thing you want to do is don't ask your questions on the fly. You want to have in your mind the message that you want this video to come out with. So in order for the video to have the right content, you've got to have questions to ask people that will help pull out that content. You don't want to ask them questions that might be interesting, but again, they're not relevant to, the message you're trying to convey in this video. So have the questions prepared ahead of time, have them rehearsed yourself, and then get them to the person or people that you're going to videotape ahead of time, so they can kind of think. Now, you don't want them to rehearse their responses, but at least give them some time to think through. Some people are very quick and on the fly can come up with perfect responses. Most people need a little bit more time to consider their responses. So if you can get that to them at least a day ahead of time, more is better. When you actually shoot the interview, when you've got the camera going, you want to ask the person their name, their title, and any other relevant information. Like this video that, again, I keep referring back to, I asked the pastor, what is your name? How do you spell your name? Do you go by pastor or reverend or doctor? That sort of thing, so I got their title correct. This serves two purposes. Number one, that way you've got on video how the person's name should be spelled and what their correct title is. You don't have to worry about having mistranslated something when you wrote it down or losing the notepad. You've got that information recorded, so if you do any subtitles, you'll have that information. The other thing is that it allows you to check sound levels. You can hear the person. Like one of the people I taped, I had to keep asking the person to raise their voice level. I moved the camera as close as I could. The person just has a quiet voice, and I had to keep asking them to speak up, so checking sound levels was important. And the other thing is that it puts them at ease because it gets them focused on doing something that they're very familiar with. They know their names, or at least they should. They know how to spell them and that kind of thing. So it's a way to put the person at ease so when you start the interview, they're not all tight and tense. They're kind of loosened up a little bit. So that's just an interview tip is probably the best tip on interviewing I can give you, is just have them give you that information ahead of time to get them loosened up. Now, when you're recording the interview, something you need to know and something you need to let the interviewees know is that you're going to use at least two, probably three takes. And just ask them, you know, to understand and not be upset if you ask them to do something four or five times. There could be a whole host of reasons, but the reason you do at least two takes is, number one, people rarely answer a question the same way twice. So you might find, if you got video editing software, is that you might use the response from one question that they did in the first take, but in the second take, they answered this other question much better, so you're going to use the video from that take instead, and then you splice two together into a single interview. Another reason you will ask them to maybe not do the whole thing over, but repeat the answer to a particular question. Some people can, especially when they're excited, they talk very fast, and there may be like a 5-second segment that you want to splice out, but they talk so fast that they were saying something, blah, 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 and then they got this 5 seconds of great information, then some more, blah, 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 whatever, and it's very hard to edit that out. So you might want to go back and have them just say that piece with a little pause before and afterwards, so that when you're video editing, it's easier for you to splice those pieces together because you've got this pause on either side of what the person said. Another reason you might ask them to do a third shoot is just because the first two weren't that good. Or they might not be happy. I mean, you might think, the second take was great, and they're like, no, I really want to do this over. Let them do it over. And like I said, ask them to repeat important information. As you're listening, if you hear something that's really important, go ahead and have them repeat that and make sure you get the pause in before and after so you can splice it in. Another thing, when you're interviewing, don't be afraid to go off base with the questions. I shouldn't say off base, but off track with the questions. You may have 5 questions you're going to ask somebody in the interview, and the answer to question 4 triggers something, so you ask some follow-on questions. Don't be in such a hurry to get to question 5. If they're on a topic right now that you think is really of value for the video, go ahead and probe a little deeper and ask more questions. And I won't say which, but if you go back and look at that video that I shot, there was one person, I asked only 2 questions. Why did your church get involved with each, and what did your church do to be involved with each? And those are the only 2 questions I asked. And this one person, I didn't like really their responses to either question, but they said something, so I started asking some other questions. We talked for 15 minutes, and out of that 15 minutes, I got some great interviewing material from them because they were more relaxed and they were just at ease now. They weren't trying to do this pre-recorded message that they kind of rehearsed. So, anyway, lighting. Here's the basics of lighting. In lighting, you're basically concerned with 3 light sources. Your key light, which is your primary light. Now, this can come from a large floodlight if you happen to have that, and that's great. There's your equipment. If you don't have the floodlight, which most of us won't have that or have access to it, a window shining in bright natural sunlight is good, or even just a reading lamp or a desk lamp that's close to somebody, I mean, not right next to them, but near them, that can provide great light. Now, the other thing you need in addition to the key light is a knockout light. And this is either a smaller light that's the same distance as the key light from the subject, or it's the same size as the key light, but it's much farther away. The purpose of the knockout light is to knock out the shadows created by the key light. So you've got this 1-2 effect. You might end up in a situation where you've got 2 lights, they're the same size, they're the same distance to the subject. If that's what you've got, that's what you have to work with. But the problem with that is it tends to wash out the face. You want one side a little more brightly lit. The other side, you don't want shadows. You want just enough light to knock out those shadows. That gives a much more natural image on the camera. Now, the backlight, what the purpose of the backlight is to knock out the shadows from the key light and the knockout light. So the backlight simply just takes care of those background shadows. That's not as important. If you end up with shadows behind someone, as long as the shadows have a soft or feathered edge to them, that's fine. If you have really harsh, sharply defined shadows, that can be distracting. People are watching the shadows in addition to the person, and it takes their mind off the video. So that's the purpose of having the backlight. Now, if you have a backdrop, or if you shoot the person against a dark background or a background that's kind of got a modeled design to it, that can mask or camouflage those shadows so you don't need the backlight. So you definitely need some kind of bright light so that people can see your subject. You need some kind of knockout light, whether it's a desk lamp or even, you know, overhead lighting in some instances can work if you position topics right. But that's the reason you need those two lights in the backlight. If you have it, great. If you don't fret the situation. Something else I want to talk about lighting here, too, because I saw this recently, is you want to make sure that your subject is brightly lit from the front, not from behind. Try to avoid shooting people against reflective surfaces or against a window if it's a brightly lit day outside. Now, if it's a cloudy day, that's not too bad. But I saw a video recently where, you know, there was this big picture window. They shot the subject against the window. They obviously had some kind of key light available because you could see the person, but their image was almost kind of silhouetted because the window, it was a southern exposure, so light was coming right in the window on the back of the subject. So just make sure you avoid that. And again, try to look for those reflective surfaces too so you don't end up with bright spots. Lighting, okay, I already talked about silhouettes. Look for reflective glasses. Outdoors, if you're going to shoot outdoors, try to shoot on a cloudy day. Now, sometimes there's an event you can't schedule what the weather's going to be like during the event. But if you can, just try to, if you have an option, if you have a choice, try to find a partially cloudy day, not really dark gray clouds, but a partially cloudy day to help soften the light so you don't get those harsh shadows. Now, you're probably not going to shoot vehicles too much, but if you're going to shoot pictures or video of your building for some purpose, a great way to light these is either early morning or early or late evening when the sun is low in the horizon. And that way you get light shining in directly instead of overhead, so you avoid some of those shadows. And the other thing is you turn on all the interior lights. And sorry, it's going to run up your electric bill, but you turn on, you get a porch light, you know, window lights, whatever, turn on all those interior lights to help the building glow from inside, and you get a really nice effect with that. If you look at any magazine with a car or truck ads, especially if the vehicle is not moving, it's just kind of sitting there, almost guarantee it was probably shot late evening or early morning. Sound. If you have a backdrop, you're in pretty good shape, but if you don't have a backdrop, try to shoot in a room or against a wall with sound-absorbing materials like curtains and fabrics. You want to, because what happens with curtains or fabrics or a surface that has kind of a three-dimensional shape to it, you know, like maybe a corrugated shape or whatever, is that it helps break up the sound waves so that they don't reflect directly into the camera and you end up with a subtle echo to it. Like, the difference can be if you happen to have a cubicle somewhere, videotape someone against a cubicle wall, and then take them into a basement and shoot them against a cinder block wall, and you'll notice a dramatic difference in the quality of the sound. So that's all I'm trying to get at, is if you don't have a backdrop, try to make sure that you've got either, like I said, sound-absorbing materials like curtains and fabrics, or sound-diffusing effects like even desk lamps, pictures, things that help break up the sound waves. Make sure your phone is off, their phone is off, the phone isn't going to ring. If there's a clock that chimes, turn it off or move it to another room. In one of the videos I shot, we actually had a problem with the furnace. The room I was shooting in was two rooms away from the boiler room, and every time the furnace kicked on, you hear the kind of thing. And you can see the spike in the sound meter on my camera. So, so what we had to do, fortunately, it wasn't frigidly cold outside, but we just turned off the furnace for that room. Now, after a half hour, it was starting to get a little bit chilly, but we were done. We didn't freeze, but just something you need to be aware of. And again, put on a recording do not disturb sign on a door if you're shooting in an office or if you're, whatever room you're shooting in, try to put a sign by all the doors so people don't inadvertently walk in and make you have to, you know, take another take. Some simple videos. I don't expect you to write these down. I'll have the, I'll have the PDF of this presentation available on epc.org later, so you can click on these and go to these. But what I want to show you with these simple videos, these are by simple videos, I mean the message certainly is not simple. I mean, it can be. But what is, they didn't have a lot of sets. They didn't have a lot of actors. They didn't use a lot of extra equipment. These are very inexpensively made videos, but the message is very powerful. They did it with just a small amount of equipment and a small budget, or in some instances, no budget. Just volunteers, put their time in on this. So anyway, I just wanted to let you know that video does not have to be a grand or expensive production. Okay, what can you expect from YouTube and Vimeo? Now, my next slides, these are all going to come from YouTube, but some of this information also applies to Vimeo. Now, with YouTube and Vimeo, you have to do all your own marketing and promotion. They're not going to promote your videos for you. You're not going to get to the top of the pick list. YouTube has if you've ever watched a YouTube video at the end, it always suggests new videos. And they've got an algorithm that calculates that, and nobody really understands what all goes into that algorithm. But just so you know, they're not going to play the next video in your list for you. You've got to promote these things through your Sunday bulletin, through your website, through whatever other promotional materials you use. But on that hand, Vimeo will give you some information. YouTube will give you a lot of information, actually almost to the point of confusion, so I'm going to try to sort that out for you. Some YouTube basics. Obviously, you have to create an account. After you create an account, the next thing you want to do is set up a channel. Now, what a channel does for you is it acts kind of like your YouTube website. It's kind of like the same thing as your Facebook fan page. It's a place for you where you can put your church's name, you can select the colors to some degree, so it has kind of your look. You can upload your videos, they're collected in one place. So that's what your channel is. It's your space on YouTube. Same thing with Vimeo. The next thing you want to do is create a playlist. Playlist is kind of like a photo album, but for videos. It's a collection of your videos that are related to each other, either related by topic, they're related by event, they're related by date that they're shot. A video can belong to more than one playlist. So you may do, let's say you're doing a six sermon series on a particular topic. If you shoot video that's related to each of those sermons, you want to put those six videos together in one playlist. But one of the videos in that playlist might relate to another topic, and you've got another playlist that's just on that topic with videos pulled in from all different series. So that's what you can do with the playlist. And of course, after you create the channel and the playlist, you need to upload the videos so you've got something for people to watch. Now, the video that I've been referring to, this is a shot from it. And what I want you to see here, this is what the EPC YouTube channel looks like. These colors don't exactly match the colors on our website. YouTube doesn't let you design the colors exactly. They have a palette that you can pick from, and this is the closest thing I could find to our color combination. So there is a downside to that, but you can pick these background colors up here. You can pick the link colors. I chose white because that looked the best. Turns out with brown, you can't really mix in yellow or green, and blue doesn't look good, so I kind of got stuck with white here. And the other thing is I'm not an artist. Maybe you are, and you can fix things up better than that. But anyway, this is what your YouTube channel looks like. It's got your video, and with your YouTube channel, you can select, let's say you have 8 playlists. You can select which playlist you want to highlight and which video you want to highlight. So I've chosen that I've got a playlist where I collect videos from other EPC churches. So that's what you see along the right-hand edge here. These are 3 videos, one that I shot and 2 from other EPC churches. And I put those in our featured playlist. I also have a featured video set up, so when people come to the EPC's YouTube channel, this is the first video that they'll see. Now, they're free to select others, but by default, this is the thing that they're going to see. And this is great. You might want to shoot a short 2 or 3 minute welcome from your senior pastor welcoming people to your church, and that's your featured video. That might be something that you put into a playlist because you want to rotate other videos in. You might always want to keep that welcome video there. My recommendation is that probably at least every 3 months you want to be looking at your YouTube channel and refreshing it. Either change your featured video or completely change your featured playlist. Simply because people do come back and they bookmark channels, they do visit them. And if they're just seeing the same welcoming video every time, they're going to assume that nothing is new here. So your featured video is a way to let people know, hey, something is new at our channel. Playlist. Now, I already talked about playlists or collections of videos. Now, what I've done is here up at the top here where it says Evangelical Presbyterian Church, to the right of that, and I did spell out church. I just cut it off because that's as much banner space as you get. But to the right of that where it says playlist, you click that button. It shows you all the playlists that we have. So I've got one playlist that features videos from EPC churches. I've got another playlist that features the videos from our 30th General Assembly last year. So after this year, I hope that I'll have another playlist with videos from the 31st General Assembly. They're sharing your videos. Right below the video, if you click on the share button, you've got a bunch of options here. Most obvious one here is this hyperlink. You can put that anywhere. You can put that in an email message, put it in your web page, do whatever you want with it. But that's how you can point people to this specific video. If you click on the embed button, right below that, the white text highlighted in blue, that's your embed code. That's information that you give to your web manager, and they can take that and put that embed code on your web page. Now, the difference between putting the link and the embed code, if you put a link, it's strictly a link on your web page. People click on it, and it'll take them to YouTube to play the video. The embed code, on the other hand, is a piece of HTML that when people come to your website, when they hit the page that has this embed code, the video will play on that page. And you can have text and pictures and all kinds of other stuff that video is included in whatever else is on that page of your website. The other nice thing is that where the link sends people to YouTube, the embed code lets people stay at your website but still view the video. It's stored on YouTube. It's played from YouTube. It sucks up their bandwidth, not yours. So that's the real advantage of the embed code. Now the email, the it video, all that's going to do is launch whatever email program you use, and it's going to include this link that's up here in your email message, so it saves you a step. Facebook and Twitter, same kind of thing. It's either going to launch your Facebook account or your Twitter account, and it's just going to put this link up there for you. So it's just a way to save a step. Personally, I don't like using the Facebook and the Twitter buttons because I would rather take the link and then craft my own message rather than just watch this video. You know, why watch this video? I'd say, hey, if you've got a question about the nature of God, watch this video. See, much more inviting, much more informative, much more likely people will click on that and open it up. Insights. This is now going further into my channel here. If you click on the Insights button for your channel, it'll show you all of your videos that you have, and it'll give you information. How many times was the video viewed? How many comments did you get? How many times did people like it? So it's a quick way to look at all your videos and see which ones are getting viewed and which ones aren't. Now if you want, you can then click on, you see there's a button here that says Edit and then Insight. If you click on the Insight button, that will then take you to this screen, which will give you all kinds of information about your video. It'll show you a cumulative running total of how many people have viewed your video. It'll also show you different milestones in your video's history. Like as you can see, it's kind of hard to see the way this is drawn, but the line that has the J-I-H-G-F-E-D. As you can see, on the first day that we announced our video, we hit a lot of different milestones. A link was shared by Twitter. The video was viewed from Facebook. The video was uploaded. The video was shared by another YouTube user, that sort of thing. Then, as time goes on, the milestones get fewer and farther between, but you still get an idea of, you know, the first time that somebody embedded your video in their website or their blog. So you get that kind of information. So it's a way to track not only what's happening with your video, but you can correspond it to your own promotional efforts. We saw, for instance, just looking at the raw numbers, we initially promoted the video through Facebook and Twitter. We got a few, you know, about 60 hits that way. And then we sent it out on EP News, which is our 2,000 member email distribution list, and we got more than 100 hits in a 2-day period. So we can see that here looking at the insights. Now another thing that, this here is kind of more art than science, but this hotspots video or insight, What this does is it takes your video and it compares it to other videos of similar size, duration, I should say, and looks at the interest level, how interested were people in your video compared to similar ones. So what this shows us is that, you know, a lot of people opened up the video, and then as time went on, interest dropped until about the 3.5 minute point. So like I said, people want to see 2 to 3 minute videos, 3 to 5 minute videos, and about 3.5 minutes, we compared to other videos of this size, we were losing our audience. However, had the line kept going down, that would just tell me that our video was increasingly dull. But because the line goes up, that doesn't mean that they clicked back in and finished the video. But again, you always have to think any point in time here. It's how did the video do at this point in time compared to others? And as you can see, the line went dramatically up. So what this tells me is that a lot of people who started the video finished the video. They stayed and watched through the whole 7 minutes. Of those people who did decide not to finish the video completely, they stopped watching at about the 3.5 minute point. So this is something for you to watch as you produce your videos to see where are people losing interest and why. Now at this point, since people lost interest halfway through, that tells me that first off, they just weren't really that interested in the topic. They weren't really, maybe they had to leave for some reason. You get some of that as well. People had to leave their computer, whatever. Or as we talked about last week, you know, people who are, you know, viewing more stuff online through their phone, maybe their bus ride was over or their elevator ride, wherever it was they were watching their video. So, I mean, don't take this too critically, but again, it's just something to be aware. If you see a continual drop and decline, you don't see an uptick near the end, that tells you that there is something in the way that you're shooting your videos that's not engaging with people. Now, this is a chart from an Excel spreadsheet I put together, and what I wanted to show you here is that as we worked on as we promoted the video, initially, here, let me back up a minute. Okay, what you're looking at here, the blue line that kind of climbs along the chart, it's kind of got some hills here, that represents the video that I shot with the interview with the 6 EPC pastors. And this first red triangle, you can see, you know, it's getting some slow growth. And then I had some other videos that were already out on our YouTube channel. And just because I promoted a new video, people saw videos that were in the playlist, and so they clicked on those as well. So we got a small uptick in 2 of the 4 videos that I already had out there. As time went on, this blue line continues to go up at a gradual pace until we get the second red box here. And inside the second red box, you can see this big jump. That's where we sent out a link to the video in EP News where it went to 2,000 people. So we got, like I said, more than 100 people watched the video in a 2-day period. And again, in Afterglow, this time, 3 of our 4 videos, we saw an increase in viewing. Like I said, it's an Afterglow effect. People watch one video, a few of them, if they've got time, they'll see, well, what are some of these other videos? Now, what I want to tell you about the third box here, the third red box you're looking at, I changed the playlist. Instead of promoting videos from our 30th General Assembly, which is what I've had in the playlist, I then put in a video from 2 other EPC churches. Now, what happened is we promoted this video, our video, to our 2,000 people distribution list a week later. Some of them open up their email. We just know that people open up their email typically on Thursdays and Fridays on our distribution list. And so a week later, some people have been on vacation, whatever, they open up this video. So we got another increase in the viewership of our video. We also got an increase in viewership of these other 2 videos that I had included. What we didn't get an increase were the videos I had in the playlist that I took out of the playlist. So people aren't likely to go through your YouTube channel and see all the videos you have. What they're going to do is look at the video you send them a link to, and then a small percentage, probably about 2% of them, maybe more if it's, you know, just focused on your congregation, you might get 5%, will look at another video. So just something to be aware of. If you're thinking people watch one video, then they're going to watch another one, that's not likely to happen, unless the videos are part of a series. This is where if you take 6 videos and you state right at the beginning, you know, this is part 1 of 6, part 2 of 6, whatever. People, if they like the first video, they will hunt through your channel to find the others. So make it easier for them to find by putting all of those videos together in a playlist. Okay, wrap up. So what did we talk about? We talked about why use video. They're a great way to pose questions to help support the sermon for that Sunday. They're a great way also to get conversations going for small groups or for evangelism activities. They're also a great way to make a call to action, get people signed up or registered or involved in something. In looking at equipment, we found out that, yeah, you need a video camera. It doesn't have to be a great video camera, but more important is the lighting and sound than the actual video camera, which is why we looked at how you shoot good video, how you set up proper lighting, how things to make sure you've got good sound, and also we looked at YouTube and what you need to do in promoting your videos for YouTube. Some homework. I'd like you all to make videos if you're not already doing that. What I'd like you to do is go to the leadership of your church, ask them if they'd be willing to use video in the service or on the website. Tell them that this is something that you'd like to do. You don't have a project yet. You're going to come back to them with some ideas, but before you spend any time trying to generate these ideas, you want to know, if we produce a short video, 2 to 3 minutes, maybe 4 minutes, is this something that you would use? If they give you the go-ahead, get an outline of upcoming sermons, at least 4 weeks out, more, maybe you want to go 8 weeks out even, to give you some time to pull your team together and shoot a video, because you want to make sure, again, that your video is relevant to the message. So get an outline of what that sermon is going to be about. Find people in your church who either have done acting, they're visual thinkers, that they have video cameras, they like to shoot video, they like to shoot photography, maybe they like to work on the computer, so they've got some editing software. Get those people together and form a team. As a team, generate some concepts. It's like, here's what the sermon's going to be about 8 weeks from now. What kind of video can we create? Now, the problem, when you brainstorm together, you're going to get a lot of ideas, but the thing is, you're only going to shoot one. So you got to let everybody know ahead of time, out of all these great ideas we're all going to come up with, we're only going to do one. So please, everybody, let's work together and not be sad that your idea didn't get picked. Take the idea, go back to your leadership, pitch the idea, see if it's something that they're willing to say go ahead with, get permission from them, and then go ahead and begin the filming. Now, again, going back to the equipment a little bit, last week we talked about the mobile revolution, and if you didn't see the, I shouldn't say last week, 2 weeks ago, if you didn't see the presentation on the mobile ministry, you want to go back and look at that, because near the end I show the effect of a traditional mail campaign versus a Facebook campaign. The videos that were used in that campaign that were uploaded to Facebook were shot with an iPhone. So they didn't even have a true video camera, they just used an iPhone. Now they had really good lighting, they had a rehearsed script, so they did rehearse it several times before they even filmed it. They did have some video editing software, so they didn't have to do, 7 or 8 takes. They did do a couple of takes, they did reshoot a couple of scenes. But again, they shot it with an iPhone. So go ahead and do your filming, and then put your project together, and then send me a link to it so I can see it when it's done. The other homework, as usual, if you haven't invited somebody, please do. Our membership has kind of grown flat. I'm hoping to at General Assembly in 2 weeks to bring some more people into our group, but if you haven't invited anybody else, either within your church or in a church nearby, please do so. And again, if you've got a Facebook page, a Twitter account, anything, let us know so I can connect with you. So, and especially if you have a Twitter account, I'm going to be tweeting from General Assembly. So if you want to follow what's going on, make sure to follow EP Church on Twitter and be looking for the hashtag #31GA. So with that, I'm all done. I'm going to unmute everybody and open it up for questions. So who's got questions about video? Whoops. Or who wants to comment on what a fabulous job I did as a presenter?
You did do a fabulous job. We have nobody. We have a small elderly church.
So okay.
Something I make notes and I'll go back and listen to your recording when it becomes useful, and I hope it will become useful, but right now it's beyond my imagination for our church to be producing video. The pastor does download and use videos that he buys different places.
Oh, you see, that's a great start. I'm glad you brought that point up because I haven't even touched on that. That, you know, you don't have to produce your own videos. Now, it's better because obviously they're customized to fit in with not only the sermon messages, but they fit in with the culture of your church. But if you can't create your own videos, there are videos that you can either purchase or sometimes even, stuff you can find on YouTube. Or sometimes I've even seen, like, clips from a movie. Now, obviously, you're going to show a large portion of a movie. You need to, there's licensing issues there. But if you're just going to use a short 30 to 60-second clip from a movie, you can even use that effectively to set up the question that's coming into the sermon. A church I used to attend, good grief, I think the person who did our video was a real fan of Saving Private Ryan because we used clips from that probably 3 or 4 times a year, not always the same clip. And then when Sixth Sense came out, we were talking about what is the afterlife. And so we had that segment where the kids telling Bruce Willis he sees dead people. So that's another way that you can use video. And that's a good place to start because it gets your church used to seeing video on a Sunday morning, so it's not quite a surprise. And that helps you also, because what'll happen once you start using video, then you'll get some people like, well, why do we do our own videos? And that's where you find your team to begin with. So I'm glad you mentioned that. But any other thoughts, comments, questions, observations?
I have just one question. You mentioned I was active on Twitter. Were you talking about my Twitter account or our church Twitter account?
Oh, either.
You noticed both, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. In terms of following what's going on at General Assembly, whatever account you want to log into, just look for the #31GA hashtag. I had a question or a comment I was going to make about video. I forgot what it was already. Okay. Well, I know what I was going to say. In addition to the PDF of this presentation, so you can get all those website addresses, I will have a spreadsheet comparing the 10 video editing programs that I looked at before we purchased video editing software here. Now, you can arrange the criteria any way you want. Again, import formats were important for me, so I put that one near the top of my spreadsheet. So out of the 10 I compared, I easily knocked it down to 4 that I was looking at. And then from those 4, starting to look at things that were important to me, like transitions and the ability to import pictures and such, because I knew I would want to do that. That really helped me narrow down eventually the program. It eventually came down to 2 programs. It was almost a coin toss which one I picked. So, all right. Well, if there's no other questions or comments, I'll let you guys go. Thanks for chiming in with your questions. And 2 weeks from now, I'll be at General Assembly. 2 weeks after that is 4th of July. And 2 weeks after that, I think I'll still be on vacation. So I'll send out a link if I'm going to be back July 18th. Otherwise, I'll see all of you in August with hopefully a topic that's of interest and use for everybody. So, have a good day, y'all.
Thank you.
Yep, bye.
Bye.